Evening, everyone. Thank you for attending the public meeting for the Centennial M-1 property. I am Tammy Pickens, the public participation specialist for the Department of Toxic Substance Control. Next slide. By participating in this meeting, you understand that this meeting is being recorded and you may be muted for background noise. During the question and comment, we will focus on topics related to today's presentation. We will do our best to listen and address all comments and questions so that everyone can participate. Thank you for your patience and understanding. Next slide. The purpose of tonight's meeting is to provide information regarding the Centennial M1 cleanup project, answer questions regarding the presentation, and receive comments on the remedial action plan. Presentation materials will be available after this meeting at www.envirostore.dtsc.ca.gov, ID number 600-00-716. Media questions may be directed to Sanford Sandy Nax at DTSC Office of Communications at sanford.nax@dtsc.ca.gov. Next slide. The mission of DTSC is to protect California's people and the environment of harmful effects of toxic substance by restoring contaminated resources, enforcing hazardous waste laws, reducing hazardous waste generation, and encouraging the manufacture of chemically safer products. Next slide. The meeting agenda will include a technical presentation, clarifying questions, and public comments. Next slide. Our DTSC presenter is Dean Wright. Dean?
Thank you, Tammy, and welcome everyone. My name is Dean Wright, and I am DTSC's project manager for the proposed cleanup project on the Centennial M1 property. As Tammy mentioned, what we're gonna do now is I'll give a brief presentation that provides some information about the site and the proposed remediation effort. I'm not gonna go into great detail, but when I'm done, hopefully everyone that's with us this evening will have a general understanding of how we're planning to make this site safe for future use. After I'm done, I'll turn it back over to Tammy and to everyone who's joined us for questions and comments. So with that, let's get started. Next slide. This slide just presents the bullet points that I'm gonna be talking about and touching on. We'll take a look at project location. I'll talk a little bit about the mining history, previous investigations that were found during previous investigations on the site. We'll look at proposed cleanup options. Proposed cleanup options and the actual remedy that's being proposed in the remedial action plan. And then, like I said, we'll turn it back over to everyone for questions. Next slide. So this slide shows the location of the Centennial M1 property. It is located adjacent to Grass Valley, California at 10344 Centennial Drive in Nevada County. To help orient you a little bit, the north direction is located at the top of the map you see on this slide. So if you follow Highway 4920 there to the northeast, it will take you right into Nevada City, which is located just off the top of the map. This entire Grass Valley, Nevada City region was actively mined for gold for about a 100-year period from roughly 1860 to 1960. And there are numerous mines associated with the region. It's not a surprise that the environmental issues at the Centennial M1 site are a direct result of this past mining activity. And I'll talk a bit more about that history just a little bit later in the presentation. Next slide. So this slide is just showing a closer view of the site. It consists of approximately 56.5 acres and includes six parcels. You can see from this slide that the northern and western borders are also the boundaries for the city of Grass Valley. So the site is not within city limits, but it's right next door. The site is currently zoned for light industrial activities, and the proposed cleanup is designed to meet this use. The property around the site is currently used for commercial industrial purposes or is open space. Next slide. So this slide presents a few bullet points on the history of the site and its ties to the nearby mining operations. Records indicate that mining for gold in the area began around 1863, and the site was used to store waste rock and mine waste from these activities. The Idaho, Maryland mine is the closest mine to the site, and it's located just to the northeast. In the early 1900s, a 20 stamp mill was built adjacent to the site for processing gold ore obtained from the Idaho, Maryland mine. And in 1936, a ball mill was also built for this purpose. And these mills just use different techniques to crush large chunks of ore rock into fine sand-sized particles to prepare the ore for gold recovery. Mining operations at the Idaho Maryland mine continued until about 1957, and the only major interruptions were during World Wars I and World War II, so almost about a 90-year period of mining. The Idaho Maryland mine was a very productive mine as well, produced approximately 2.4 million ounces of gold, and was considered the second largest gold mine in the United States in the early 40s. And lastly, in the late 80s, improvements in gold extraction resulted in approximately 7,700 tons of tailings actually being removed from the site for additional processing at a location in Clear Lake, California. So we'll take that as a win. At least 7,700 tons of potential problem was removed in the 80s. So next slide. So this slide I really like, because I think it's going to help everyone kind of understand the site a little bit. Those numbers correlate to different features on not just the Centennial M1 site, but also some of the features on the Idaho Maryland mine site that's right next door. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about each one of these numbers, and hopefully that's going to help everyone understand the site a little better. So we'll start with numbers 1 and 2, kind of in the upper right there. That is the location of the headframe and the hoist house of the Idaho Maryland mine. This is where the mine shaft, or the main shaft of the Idaho Maryland mine, was located. And you can see from this photo, these features are not on the Centennial M1 property, but they're right next door. Likewise, numbers 3 and 4, representing the locations of the 20 stamp mill and the ball mill, respectively. Again, located right next to the Centennial M1 site, but not on the property. And then we move over to our site property, and you can see the waste rock and tailings outlined in green. There's quite a bit of it, as you can see. The remedial action plan divides the waste rock and tailings into two main areas. One is called the Eastern Tailings Pond, or the ETP, and it's shown as number 5 on the photo. The other is the Western Tailings Pond, or the WTP, and it's shown as number 6 on the photo. And if you were to draw a line right between number, right down the middle of the site from number 8 and down through the middle, basically everything on the right would be Eastern Tailings Pond, everything on the left would be Western Tailings Pond, roughly. Not all the material that you see in this photo presents a problem, but there are large portions in the northern part of the Western Tailings Pond and the eastern part of the Eastern Tailings Pond that we definitely need to remediate. And there are several other smaller areas within the tailings ponds that also need remediation. The remedial action plan calls those small areas hotspots. Moving on to number 7, this is the former location of an elevated tailings conveyance system that actually conveyed mine waste, mine tailings from the Idaho Maryland mine over the Eastern Tailings Pond and dumped them into the Western Tailings Pond. If you actually look at the remedial action plan itself, I think it mislabels this feature as a ditch, because that's what we originally thought it was, but subsequent research has found out that it was an above ground conveyance system. Either way, number 7 is a feature that got mine waste from the Idaho Maryland mine onto the Centennial M1 property. Moving on to numbers 8 and 9, those are location of large long berms at the site that exist near its northern and eastern boundaries. The northern berm, number 8 on the photo, was constructed to confine the mine waste to the site. The eastern berm, number 9 on the photo, there you go, was initially built to support the log pond that is immediately east of the site. This log pond is visible as that large dark area to the right or east of number 9. However, the eastern berm also serves to help confine the mine waste to the site as well. And we found that mine waste is deepest at these berms. It can be over 25 feet thick at these features. But as you move south and west, it appears that the mine waste thins out pretty quick. And the average thickness of the mine waste on the site is less than 5 feet. Number 10 is a ditch that was originally constructed again to service that log pond mentioned earlier. However, we also think it helped to serve to deliver mine waste to the tailings ponds. Number 11 is called the South Idaho location. And this was an area that had some mine waste associated with it, but not much. The remedial action plan looks at this area separately because it's nowhere near as big of a problem as the eastern and western tailings ponds. And lastly, we have the location of the Hap-Warnke lumber mill. That doesn't have a number associated with it, but there you go. It's right in between numbers 8 and 3. And this is another area where we didn't have any evidence of mine waste being deposited at this location. And indeed, the remedial action plan found that we will not have to do any remediation at this part of the site. And I guess Lastly, I should probably point out the location of Wolf Creek. It's that thin blue line to the just at the north end of our property, kind of heads off to the east and west, but it mimics the north boundary. That is an area that we want to stay away from. And luckily for us, all of our mine waste is south of Wolf Creek. So it doesn't look like we're going to be impacting Wolf Creek with our remedy, which is very good news. Next slide. So what did we find at the site? Obviously, from the previous slide, we found a lot of waste rock and mine tailings. In fact, approximately 37 acres of the 56-acre site is covered with this material. Metals are generally the contaminants of concern in mine waste because the process of recovering the gold also tends to concentrate other metals that are present in the ore rock. The metals with high concentrations at the Centennial M1 site include arsenic, lead, thallium, mercury, and nickel. Other metals that were evaluated but were found to have concentrations low enough that they did not present a risk to human health include barium, cadmium, chromium, cobalt, copper, molybdenum, selenium, silver, vanadium, and zinc. Samples were also analyzed for cyanide because cyanide was used to extract gold from the crushed ore during part of the Idaho Maryland mine's operational history. Investigations at the site began around 1989, and the most recent investigations were completed in 2019. In total, these investigations resulted in over 220 soil samples being collected at the site and analyzed for contaminant concentrations. These samples were collected at depths ranging from surface down to around 17 feet. And as I mentioned previously, the result of these investigations indicate that not all the mine waste on the site presents a risk to human health, but certainly a fair amount does. And this is the material that the remedial action plan proposes to address to make the site safe for future use. Next slide. Okay, so this slide does a little better job of showing the general areas of the site where mine waste was found that needs to be addressed. As you can see, there are large areas near the northern and eastern berms where the majority of the contamination exists. The smaller circles represent the hotspots mentioned in the earlier slide, where mine waste will also potentially need to be excavated. This map also shows the location of what is called the TP19 hotspot. It's that small circle within the Eastern Tailings Pond oval right there. This particular area is going to need a little more attention than just excavation, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later on in the presentation, but I thought since it's pointed out now and it's labeled on this particular slide, it's good to let you know where it is so that when I do talk about it, you'll know the area I'm referencing. Next slide. I thought I'd include a few pictures. Pictures usually help tell the story. So the picture on the right is a larger view of the site. And the picture on the left is obviously a close-up view of one of the sampling locations. In both pictures, what you see on the ground there is called mine tailings. And you can see that it's a pretty fine sand-sized material. This close-up view on the right also gives you an idea of how surface soil samples were collected, at least during the 2019 investigations. They used a clean hand shovel to collect the soil. Place it into a laboratory supplied resealable plastic bag. Those bags were then labeled and shipped off to the laboratory for analysis. Deeper samples collected during earlier investigations were obtained using either a hand auger or a drill rig to reach the desired deeper depths. As mentioned earlier, the mine waste on the property also includes waste rock, which is the material that was not considered ore material and did not undergo any gold processing. And that material can have a range of sizes anywhere from as fine a material is what you see here, all the way up to large cobble sized. There's a lot of waste rock on the site as well. I don't have any pictures of it, but if you can envision sand and gravel of all sizes, you have a pretty good idea what waste rock looks like. Next slide. So this slide is just a table of the contaminants I mentioned that have concentrations above the acceptable risk levels, our five bad actors, if you will. The middle column shows the highest concentrations we've found on the site for each contaminant in milligrams per kilogram. The column on the right shows the cleanup levels for each contaminant. Those cleanup levels are all based on commercial industrial use, all except for arsenic, which uses naturally occurring background as a cleanup level concentration. I also should point out that the background level we found here is actually pretty low for the region. DTSC has worked on sites where background in the region has been over 100 milligrams per kilogram. So again, 18 is a pretty low number for Grass Valley and Nevada City. As you compare the cleanup goals to the high concentrations you see in that middle column, it's pretty apparent that we're not where we want to be. And that's why a remedy is necessary for this site. So next slide. So this slide presents the different ways that were looked at for cleaning up the site. The remedial action plan evaluated five different cleanup options for addressing the areas of waste that need remediation. This includes a no action option that is used as a baseline. And each of these options is evaluated on nine different criteria that includes considerations like long and short-term effectiveness. We wanna make sure it's gonna work. Implementability, we wanna make sure we can do it. They look at cost, of course. And regulatory and public acceptance is also a criteria. The remedial action plan, after doing that evaluation, chose cleanup option five. This option includes the stabilization of the TP19 hotspot that I mentioned, with on-site consolidation of the remaining waste that presents a risk, and then all this material will be covered with a clean soil cap. So a little more about the TP19 hotspot. So this area is gonna need what we call stabilization, because the data indicates that contaminant concentrations here are such that they could impact groundwater through leaching. There's a potential, at least. So what does stabilization mean? Well, in this case, it simply means the mine waste will be mixed with concrete to minimize that potential for leaching to occur. The stabilization mix will consist of Portland cement, water, and mine waste, and the amount of each of these ingredients will be dependent on the dry weight of the mine waste. That dry weight will be determined based on laboratory analysis. After the material has been stabilized, it will be tested to ensure its effectiveness before it's placed in the consolidation area and cap. That's about as succinct a description of the proposed remedy as I can give you, but I'll spend the next couple of slides describing it a bit more. So next slide. So this slide shows a map of the proposed cleanup and provides probably the best resolution for letting you know where we think we'll be on the site when conducting this remediation. That darker brown area on the slide would be the mine waste consolidation area. That represents about 5.6 acres. That lighter colored circle within the brown area is the TP19 hotspot. They estimate that's about 4,200 cubic yards of soil that will need that stabilization. The lighter yellowish areas, including the small yellowish circles, which are the other hotspots, are the remaining portions of the ETP and the WTP that would be remediated by digging up that contaminated soil and placing it in the consolidation area. The consolidation area would then be covered or capped with soil from the site that meets the cleanup goals already. The cap would be graded to minimize infiltration of rainwater, and erosion control measures and groundwater monitoring would also be included as part of the remedy. They anticipate roughly that the material in yellow that you see there is about 134,000 cubic yards of material that they're potentially going to be moving to the consolidation area. So it's a fair amount of material. Then they anticipate about another 130,000 cubic yards of soil that will be obtained from the rest of the site that already meets cleanup goals to backfill the excavated areas and for use as the clean cap. So it's going to be a pretty big operation with lots of dirt being moved around. Next slide. This slide provides just a little more explanation of the remedy. Excavation of the contaminated soil would not be considered complete until confirmation samples for the contaminants of concern meet the established cleanup goals. No outside soil is anticipated for the proposed remedy. Clean soil for the consolidation area cap and backfilling of the excavated areas is all anticipated to come from the site itself. However, if offsite soil is required, it would be tested prior to being allowed on the site to ensure it meets the cleanup criteria. There will be a dust monitoring and health and safety plan followed during the remediation activities to ensure the safety of both the workers and the surrounding community. Part of the proposed remedy includes the use of land use controls that are filed with the county to ensure only the commercial industrial use of the site is allowed. Should a different type of use be proposed in the future, additional cleanup and or analysis would be required to ensure the appropriate level of safety is achieved. Lastly, the proposed remedy employs long-term operation and maintenance, including groundwater monitoring and annual inspections and repair of the cap. And as long as these long-term maintenance commitments, they last basically forever or until a regulating agency agrees they're no longer required. So unless or until technology invents a remedy that can break down this type of mine waste that it no longer presents a problem, this cap will be monitored, which in short means we'll be here a long, long time. Typically the word used is in perpetuity. Next slide. So this is the last slide of my presentation. I just wanted to touch on this future use issue because it became apparent very early on after starting this project that a big concern for the community was the potential reopening of the Idaho Maryland mine, how that might work, how the mine will operate, and the potential future use of the Centennial M1 site in the mine's operation. In particular, the potential use of the Centennial M1 site to store more mine waste. DTSC recognizes that these are all extremely important issues for the community, but I want to stress that none of them are part of this project. This project focuses solely on the cleanup of the existing mine waste and reaching a level of safety that will allow this site to be put back into productive use. That is the whole of this project. And as long as that future use is of a commercial industrial nature, DTSC really doesn't have any say in its development. Having said all that, I do think we can safely say a few things about future use, even at this early stage. So I wanted to do that too. One is that although DTSC will not be the lead regulatory agency overseeing the mine if it reopens and its operation, we would certainly be consulted when it comes to having more soil deposited on the site after the cleanup. And that would be the case whether that soil came from the Idaho Maryland mine or anywhere else for that matter. In the case of the Idaho Maryland mine, the consultation will likely be the result of our review of the county's EIR on the mine reopening, and also perhaps through our operation and maintenance efforts. It's a little early to speak specifically on conditions that DTSC or any other regulating agency might require. But generally speaking, I feel pretty safe in saying that any material being brought on the site would have to meet the cleanup criteria. We're not going to allow soil that has concentrations of contaminants that are higher than our cleanup goals to be deposited on the site. That would make no sense. And any material that is planned to be placed on top of the cap area would have to be graded and compacted to ensure the drainage and erosion control measures of the cap are maintained. I feel safe in saying that. And of course, DTSC would stay involved in the long term through the operation and maintenance agreement I mentioned earlier. I guess the one last thing I'd like to leave you with before we wrap up and turn it back over to Tammy is the understanding that the protection for both human health and the environment under this proposed remedy comes from the cap. It's that 4 to 5 foot thick layer, barrier of clean soil that's on top of the mine waste that presents a risk. So if more soil is brought to the site and that soil meets the general criteria I just mentioned, really all we're getting is a thicker cap and thus a thicker layer of protection. Obviously the trick will be putting in specific protocols to ensure those general criteria are met, if indeed that's the way this site is used. But whatever those specific protocols are, whatever they end up being, they're not part of this project. This project, again, focuses solely on the remediation of the existing mine waste. So hopefully I explained the kind of parameters of this project, because I know the other aspects I mentioned are extremely important. They're just not part of what we're doing and what we're talking about tonight. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Tammy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. We have now reached the clarifying questions session of tonight's meeting, where questions may be asked pertaining to Dean's presentation. Dean, I invite you to open your video during this portion. Next slide. This slide will provide an overview of the three ways you can ask a question or make a comment. To use Zoom audio, use the raise hand feature at the bottom of your screen. When we call on you, you'll be invited to unmute your audio. For anyone calling in by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand. I will say the last three numbers of your phone number, and when it's your turn, you will press *6 to unmute your audio. To have your question read by myself, please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. We may now begin to take questions or about Dean's presentation. The first question that we have, Dean, for you is, why was the cleanup option 4 not chosen?
Well, again, the five different options that were evaluated were based on the 9 criteria that I mentioned. I didn't mention all of them, but most of them. And after that evaluation, it turned out that that fifth and final option was going to be the best one. I'd have to look at that number four option to find out exactly what the difference was, but it was probably a situation where they wanted to off-haul, or it was an option to off-haul some of the waste. Let me move this. There we go. Yeah, it was more of the off-site disposal. Again, there is a benefit to keeping everything on site. And that benefit is just minimizing truck traffic and all the things that go with that. We think that we can deal with the TP19 hotspot very effectively with the stability that we're going to employ. So it just made sense to us after doing that criteria evaluation that the fifth option was a better way to go.
Okay, we have a question from Gary Griffith. Gary?
Hello, thanks for your presentation. I'm wondering if you could give a little sense of the history. Why didn't the previous company engage in a cleanup? Because my understanding is that typically mining operations are required to do cleanups. And why has DTSC taken as long as it has to propose a cleanup? Didn't mine operation end in 1957? It's been decades.
It has been a while. This site falls under what's called the voluntary cleanup program. And that's simply because DTSC's mandate really is to clean up the worst of the worst. Unfortunately, under that mandate, there's only so much we can do. And this site simply doesn't fall into the worst of the worst category. So they actually came up with a voluntary agreement program where if you had an RP, or I guess a project proponent would be a better term, a project proponent that wanted to clean up a site and put a site back into productive use, they could do that through the voluntary cleanup program and get our oversight. But again, because this site didn't meet kind of the worst of the worst category, it wasn't one that was going to be gotten to by DTSC for quite a while, unless it came through that voluntary cleanup approach. And the other thing, and the reason why it doesn't, you know, meet that worst of the worst is simply because in its current state, unused, it simply wasn't creating an environmental health hazard for anyone. There's nobody on the site. There's nobody actively using the site. So for those reasons, we didn't really have to go in and do anything. Now that we have a proponent that actually wants to put the site into reuse, there will be people on this site. And so that's why we're basically doing the work now, is because we have a project proponent that says, hey, I'll pay for this cleanup if I can get it back into productive use. The only way they can do that is through working with the agencies to get that cleanup certification. And that's why we're here now. As far as previous companies, that I don't know, you know, a lot of times people will purchase a property, they realize, oh boy, I stepped in it. I got this whole huge cleanup to do before I can use it, and they decide not to. And again, because it doesn't fall into the worst of the worst, DTSC is going to put it on the shelf unless and until someone else comes along that wants to work on it. This time we have a project opponent that's willing and able, and that's great news because we get one more site cleaned up.
Thank you, Gary, for that. Our next question comes from James Baer. James.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Thank you very much for the presentation. Really found it to be very thorough. Speaking a good engineer. And my questions are a little bit more broad because I'm representing an organization called the Elders Action Network. It's about 15,000 people nationwide. And we have an active group here in Northern California that is probably one of the most active in the nation. And they're very interested in this whole Idaho Maryland mine reopening. So this is actually not one of our hotspots, but I hear in your presentations some very serious concerns because many of the people are retired. The hospital for the county is not very far from the Centennial site. There are four at least medical facilities focusing on elder care in very close proximity in terms of air movement. And you said you were going to consolidate. And when one looks at the map and the acreage that you were moving debris, tailings around, it's going to take quite a bit of a diesel energy. And it's going to result, of course, not only in diesel fumes, but also in dust. and you said you were going to monitor the dust. Mm-hmm. I would like to know how you could possibly do that, especially if you're going to, you know, like they did long ago, use conveyor belts or other probably very heavy earth moving equipment. And that is of great concern to us. And I know it's not really part of the direct purpose that you are focusing on, but we think that the environmental impact is a cost of the cleanup, and the cost may be almost too much for our community to withstand, yet we have to have this cleaned up. So perhaps you can just focus specifically on the pollution characteristics of the movement of the tailings, et cetera, and also how you would keep the air clean.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And actually, the CEQA initial study that's been done for this project and is also available for review talks about those issues as well. But a couple things. The beauty of or one of the, I guess the benefit, the best benefit of this chosen remedy is the fact that it does keep the waste on the site. So you can imagine with 130 odd thousand cubic yards of soil, how many truckloads that might be if you were going to try and take that material off, or indeed even bring clean soil on. With the average, I think the average dump truck holds about 17 cubic yards. So in terms of, things like emissions and things of that nature, this proposed remedy actually is one of the best ones in that regard. As far as dust mitigation, we definitely want to make sure that not only are the workers safe, but that the community's safe. There is a dust mitigation plan that will be part of what's called our remedial design implementation plan. It's kind of the technical plan. It's kind of the how plan after the remedial action plan, which is the what, gets approved. And that dust mitigation plan will be finalized there, but there's, I think, a draft of it available in the CEQA initial study. Essentially, we're gonna have active real-time data logging instruments, both up and downwind. In addition, the most vulnerable workers, like shovel operators and what have you, will also have monitors. There are action levels for fence line dust as set in the California Code of Regulations. And if an action level is reached, then additional mitigation measures, would have to be employed. And the typical dust mitigation that'll be employed is simply spraying water wherever soil is being moved, wherever it's being excavated, what have you. But there are other measures that can be employed, and that includes stop work if we have to. If wind conditions are such that we just can't do it in a safe manner, then and action levels are reached that show that, we would stop work. There will be a site safety officer in the field at all times when work is ongoing, and they'll be in charge of monitoring those readings. And they would have the authority to make that action level decision to stop work or to increase dust control measures. Those action levels, like I said, they're set in regulation. And even though the remedial design implementation plan, has not yet been finalized, those action levels will probably be adopted. They're basically as stringent, if not more stringent, than the benchmark set by CalOSHA and the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment. But if the RDIP were to deviate, those action levels would have to be in a more stringent or more protective direction. We can't go against what's regulated. So, we feel we have the outline of a great dust mitigation plan that when we finalize it will be very protective of not only the community, but of the people actually working on the site, because we recognize dust as probably the major hazard with this kind of approach.
Okay. Now we'll go to Diana Suarez. I hope I didn't mess up your last name, Diana.
Thank you for the opportunity to comment. I have noticed in our area, most of the old mines have become parks, Empire State Park, North Star Park. What if this mine ends up becoming a park? What if there's residences on site? And what if a farmer's market happens in the middle of the site? What level of cleanup would you need? And also my concern is the groundwater. And I think that number three looks good for the groundwater. Maybe you have some other ideas, but there's no guarantee that this site will become a mine. And what if it becomes a park? What would these cleanup options facilitate a safe park for our people and good groundwater? Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Two questions there. So with respect to the proposed cleanup, I think I mentioned in the briefing that, if there's a change down the road, there would have to be additional evaluation, maybe even additional cleanup, depending on what the proposed new use was going to be. In this case, the proposed use is for commercial industrial purposes, and we're going to make sure that the site gets cleaned up to those levels. But if down the road they want to propose it for a different use, they would have to show it's going to be safe for that use. And if it's not, they would have to do some additional remediation. What that would be, I don't know. I wouldn't want to speculate exactly what they might have to do, but they would have to show that however they want to use the site, if it's different than commercial industrial and a more stringent, more protective type of use is required, they would have to meet that more stringent, more protective cleanup level. With respect to groundwater, groundwater is obviously very important. The water board mandates that we protect it. And I think this remedy does that, and it does it in several ways. And let me just kind of go over those because it's important. Groundwater is a major concern. First, I talked about the TP19 hotspot. That's one of the areas where the data indicates there might be a problem. And I talked about how we're going to address that. We think that's going to be a very effective approach. Second, once the cap is in place, all the exposed soil on the site will be safe for both people and groundwater, because everything that even presents any kind of a problem under commercial industrial use, which is also protective of groundwater, would be underneath that 4 or 5 foot thick layer cap. And then a third thing is the cap itself. Not only will there be that thick layer, but the cap will also be compacted and graded to direct water off of and away from the mine waste and away from the consolidation area. And this is a design feature that hasn't received probably a lot of attention, but it's a very important part of the design. By moving water off of the cap before it has a chance to get into the mine waste underneath there, what we're essentially doing is removing the source of groundwater contamination, which is rainwater that falls onto the site and is allowed to filter through the mine waste. I guess the last thing that we do in terms of groundwater is the plan is also calling for groundwater monitoring wells. So these wells will show if downgradient contaminant concentrations are higher than upgradient background concentrations. And even if they are, we should start to see those downgradient concentrations come back into upgradient back down to upgradient levels, because again, we'll have shut off that source, if you will. So I think it's a plan that, it very much addresses groundwater. I think it's very much going to be protective of groundwater, but we know that's one of the things that we have to consider. And the cleanup basically keeps that in, first and foremost, again, because the last thing we're doing is putting in groundwater monitoring wells, which will tell us one way or the other whether there's contamination there or not. And it will show us, if there is, that we're being effective. And if we're not, additional work would have to be done to bring us into compliance there.
Okay. Dean, I'm going to read a question from Reed Hamilton from the Q&A. He asks, who enforces the long-term monitoring?
That would be DTSC. We would be signing, we would enter into an agreement with the owner, called an operation and maintenance agreement that outlines the monitoring, the cap inspection and repair process and all of those different types of things. So DTSC would be the regulating agency for long-term maintenance and monitoring.
Okay, thank you for that. We have Aaron Crowell, who will be asking a question. Aaron.
Hi, this is Aaron Kroll and Teresa Huck on the line here.
Hello.
Hi. I wanted to ask you Is this work going to be completed before we allow them to reopen the mine?
At the current schedule, yes, I think this, you know, I don't know, again, I'm not sure exactly what the mine reopening process looks like. I know they don't even have an EIR out for public review yet. So they've certainly got some other hurdles they've got to deal with. So I would think, just based on that alone, that yes, this project would be completed before the mine is reopened. We would certainly, if for some reason it happens concurrently, that would mean obviously that they'd be wanting to use mine waste from the Idaho Maryland mine as part of the cap or part of the excavation regrading and what have you. Again, that's not called for in our plan. We think we're going to do everything with what we have on site, and we want to do everything with what we have on site. If those things change, it would be a pretty major change. I'm not sure what the Idaho Maryland mine issues are that they have to deal with reopening and operating that mine. But right now, our plan only talks about what's on site and dealing with what's on site. So I think we are going to be well ahead of the mine reopening.
Thank you, Aaron, for your question. We're now going to answer a question from Q&A. Paul Schwartz asked, what precautions will be taken during the construction to protect air quality from both toxic and non-toxic particulates?
Well, again, it's that dust mitigation plan. The contaminants at this site are the metals in the that might become, you know, airborne via the dust that might happen from excavation and what have you. So, to address that, we will have a dust mitigation plan that keeps that dust level down within levels that are safe. If we go over those safe levels, we will have to make changes or stop work. Those are the options. We can't continue to work in unsafe conditions.
And will the quality of air be monitored during the project?
Yes. Yes, we will have, I think I mentioned the real-time data loggers. I think they collect data every 5 minutes or so, and they do it on a 24-hour basis. And so we'll get some baseline information, and we'll get fence line information, and we'll have our action items. And based on those action items, we'll do what we need to do to make sure that, again, we want not just the community to be safe, we want our workers to be safe that are doing the work. They're the ones that are probably most susceptible. So it's imperative for them as well.
Okay, thank you. Jonathan Keehan. Jonathan would like to ask a question. Jonathan.
Yeah, thank you for this presentation. And I'm involved, a member of the board of directors of the Wolf Creek Community Alliance here in town. And just want to thank you for doing this. We are glad the DTSC is on the job here. We support cleaning up this site, and we just want to make sure that it's done as good a job as possible. I've got a couple of questions. First of all, I'd like to just make a comment, or actually a request, that you extend the comment period here. As you're sure you know, the RAP is 623 pages long. So far, since you sent it out 2 weeks ago, I've got up to about page 80. So I've got a lot to go, and you're only giving us 2 more weeks. So, and it's not just for me, but anyway, that's it's also for the general public, and it leads me into the second, which I'll just a question that I have, which is why the city has pre-zoned this parcel for other uses besides industrial. And as you know, the site is surrounded on three sides or two and a half sides by the city. And they have pre-zoned it, and it's in their short-term area of annexation. They're planning to do it. Actually, they planned to do it 12 years ago, but they hope to do it very soon. and they have pre-zoned it for business park and urban medium density. So I want to be sure that the city has time to comment on this on this proposal to you. So that's another reason I hope that you can extend the period. And I guess you kind of answered the question before, but why is that zoning not taken into account in setting the standard for cleanup on the site?
You know, I'm not familiar with what the city has planned. We know how it's zoned currently. We know how the owner would like to, you know, right now it's a privately owned piece of property, and that owner wants to clean it up to commercial industrial purposes, you know, commercial industrial uses. And so that's what we're doing. You know, again, if those uses change, and if those changes require a cleaner site, then some additional activities would have to, you know, be undertaken to make sure that it meets those new levels of use. But right now, like I said, we don't get to dictate. DTSC doesn't get to dictate how sites get cleaned up. If someone says, hey, we have a site that we want to clean up to commercial industrial use, great, we're all for it. It's a private, you know, their private property, or not, you know, it's their private property. They get to make those decisions I would imagine they make them in conjunction with the city or the county that they're working with, so they can use it the way they anticipate. But we don't really get a say in you know, whether it's residential or commercial industrial. We just have to make sure that when that decision is made by whatever entities, the private owner, the county, the city, it's our job to make sure that those levels are attained. I'm not really in a position to say why they're not considering future, you know, maybe they believe that the future use will be commercial industrial in nature. And so they'll meet whatever future uses are anticipated. That's all I can figure. I mean, like I said, if that site use changes and that new site use requires a stricter level, more stringent, more conservative level of cleanup, they would have to attain that.
Okay, thank you. I'm gonna read a question from the Q&A from Ralph Silberstein. There's a lot of wetlands. Why are they not being protected? West Bureau area, for example, can be mostly kept unimpacted. Why was this not an option?
Yeah, the wetlands, unfortunately, there's approximately 4.38 acres of wetlands, and I think 0.2 acres of intermittent stream bed that will be removed as a result of the remedy. Some of these wetlands exist on the mine waste, and we know we need to address those portions. So there's really no alternative there. I know that there are some areas of wetlands that also exist where we plan to borrow material. But again, if the option for not borrowing, for not using material on the site is, that is a whole level of I guess work and cost that just didn't make it feasible. Again, I say there's about 130,000 cubic yards of soil that are going to be used for regrading and the soil cap, and again that's planned to come all from the site itself, and some of that will be areas where the wetlands are. But if you, like I said, if you take the average dump truck that can bring about 17 cubic yards of soil onto the site, you're talking about a lot of soil that you're going to have to bring onto the site to regrade and to make that cap. And not only is that, you know, a time issue, it's a huge cost issue. It is a huge traffic issue, and all the implications with increased traffic on the surface roads around the site and in the city. So again, after looking at all the criteria and looking at that situation, it came down to, look, it's those wetlands are going to have to be sacrificed. Now, when that happens, the Army Corps of Engineers has jurisdiction over wetlands, and the California Department of Fish and Wildlife has jurisdiction over stream beds. So the owner will need to obtain certain permits, I think a Section 404 permit from the Corps and a Section 1602 permit from the California Department of Fish and Wildlife to work in those areas. The Corps typically requires a restoration of wetlands on a one-to-one basis, either on-site or off-site. Obviously, on-site's not an option. Off-site, maybe that's what they'll work out in their permit negotiations. And I think another option for the owner is a purchase of what they call wetland credits from a wetland mitigation bank. That's another option that I think is open to them. But again, those are criteria that will be spelled out in the permit they obtain from the Corps, which has jurisdiction over the wetlands. But the reason we can't save some of them is because they exist on mine waste that we have to address. And the others, they exist on mine waste that we have to use in order to make this cleanup feasible.
Thank you. It was stated that he asked a question, if the comment period can be extended, would you like that comment? Would you like to reserve that for a comment for you to answer later?
Yeah, because that's something I probably have to talk to you about, Tammy. I'm not sure how we would go about doing that. We'll look into it, certainly. But I don't get to make that decision, I don't think. So
okay, we'll reserve that one for a comment. Okay. So we have a question from Ray Virus. Ray.
Yeah, sorry, I typed this in, but instead of option four, could some of the south TP19 hotspots be moved on site to the east area with some clean soil brought in to cover it? This could allow much of the existing south wetlands to remain. That's my question. Thank you.
I may not understand your question completely, but it sounds like you're talking about the hot spots in kind of in the southern area of the kind of the,
yeah,
the
small, yes, circles. And the hot spots don't, from the picture, they don't seem to be that large. So I would visualize boring in and taking some chunks of soil and moving those over, and then being able to bring in a small amount of topsoil to replace the hot spots.
Yeah, I mean, again, we're actually going to be doing some pre-sampling in some of those areas to make sure we actually even have to excavate there. And if we do, we will, obviously. But if we don't, again, we know where we do have to excavate is going to be pretty extensive. And with, you know, the thinking is that, you know, we won't use more soil than we need, certainly. And if we can spare portions because we didn't have to dig as much as we thought, we certainly will, believe me. But we know that we're going to have to use some of that mine waste that does meet the cleanup criteria already as regrading and cap material. And we're pretty sure, you know, what the general cubic yardage of that is going to be. So even if some of those hotspots, you're right, they could be pretty small. Even if some of those hotspots aren't that bad, and we just do a little bit of excavation there and we find out the rest of the material around there is clean, it's likely that some of that would have to be used for regrading and cap anyway. But certainly if we don't, we won't. You know, we don't want to do any extra work that we don't have to. And, you know, we'll kind of play that one by ear a little bit. But yeah, I mean, we're only going to dig what we have to dig. And if we can minimize digging in areas that such that we don't even have to go to maybe the southern area down there, wonderful. That's we will definitely do that. We will definitely leave that area alone if we can.
Thank you for your question. Dean, we'll go back to Q&A. Josie Crawford, question is, what is in TP19 that makes it so much worse than other areas?
I believe it's, and I have some panelists on site that might be able to help me with this, but I believe it's the nickel concentrations at the TP19 hotspot that actually it's the nickel and it's the, if I remember right, it's pH issues there as well. So they're finding that the kind of the environment around the TP19 hotspot is such that it enables or could enable the leaching of mine waste because the pH is so much lower. And that is kind of anomalous, but nevertheless, that's the case there. So because of that pH issue and some of those metals concentrations there, there are some issues with potential leaching. So I think it's not only just concentrations, but also environment, pH environment. And if I'm misspeaking on that, you know, someone can jump in and fill me in, but that's what I believe, that's what I recall on TP19 hotspot.
Thank you.
Dean, this is Jason. We had soluble arsenic there as well.
Soluble arsenic there as well. Yeah. Is that again because of the pH issues?
Well, and it's because it's a different material. Most of the material that was mined in that mill came from the mine itself, mm-hmm. but at certain times they also did toll milling where they brought in materials from other sites.
Right.
And sometimes the material that was imported for milling was more mineralized. This vein is not particularly mineralized, but some of the other material that they, you know, people paid them to mill, that ended up in the spot, is just different material and it had more arsenic and it was a little bit more acidic.
Thank you. Jason, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, is the consultant that worked on the project for the owner. So he's pretty intimately familiar with this site as well. So thank you, Jason. Appreciate that very much.
Thank you, Jason. Now we'll get a question from Robert Hubert. Robert.
I understand that the DTSC is the ongoing monitoring agent for long-term monitoring of the wells and that sort of thing. But who actually does the inspection and reports to the DTSC? Is that a DTSC employee or is that left to the owner?
That can depend on the site. You know, for this site, especially if they do end up bringing material on, I think DTSC would definitely be involved in the inspection. But we have pretty benign sites that just have a fence around some soil, just as an example, where we would let the owner take a few photos and you know, go through a questionnaire and send that into us and that suffices. But in this case, I think that certainly in the near term, you know, DTSC would be on site for some of those inspections. If down the road, you know, years and years down the road, we get to the point where we know the remedy is working and everything's hunky-dory, we may allow an owner to take photos and go through a questionnaire and that type of thing. But, again, that would be spelled out in the operation and maintenance agreement that we have. But I would suspect that we would want a presence for inspections on this site.
And just to add one more thing, there would be monitoring reports required as well for the groundwater.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. We're going to take a question from the Q&A. Jillian Blanchard, DTSC regulations require the applicant to provide financial assurance in the form of performance bonds, letters of credit, or something similar to make sure that the applicant is able to finance the full cleanup and long-term monitoring you reference. What type of financial assurance will the applicant provide? Can the financial information be made public, and will DTSC ensure that the financial insurance are provided before it approves the RAP?
The financial assurance is a requirement. It will not be in place before we approve the RAP, but it is a requirement of the project and of the owner. So what form or mechanism that takes, I think they have a couple of different options. And we work with some specialists in-house that are familiar with the financial assurance mechanisms that help us with that. I don't know what they would choose for this site, but they recognize that it's a requirement. But no, it will not be in place before we approve this remedial action plan, sorry.
Okay. And then we have Erin Crowell. She's asking another question. Erin?
I asked this question because I have actually received mercury poisoning from the Lost Lake leg of our mine system here. And the question I have is, how can you put that cap on and prevent, like, 100 years from now, does the cement not break down? How can you prevent long-term effects on the population who will live here 100 years from now?
Again, that's through our operation and maintenance. That is why we have long-term operation and maintenance built into the remedy, because we do expect we will be here 100 years from now monitoring this site. You know, the funny thing about, or the unfortunate thing I should say about mine waste is you can't really break it down to the point where it's not a problem. You can either pick it up and move it somewhere else or deal with it where it is. But wherever you put it, it's going to be somewhere where you need to monitor, whether that's in a landfill or at your site. So it's always going to need to be monitored wherever it is. By leaving it here, we avoid a whole lot of traffic issues, a whole lot of just a whole lot of problems that go along with moving 130 odd thousand cubic yards of soil. Not to mention the material that would have to be brought on if we wanted to use clean soil from elsewhere. So it's the operation and maintenance. And yes, we do intend to be monitoring this for a long time, but that monitoring again would have to go on no matter where you put this waste.
Thank you for that question. We'll take a question from Q&A. William Clark. William asks, why hasn't residential use considered in this cleanup project? This parcel is within the spheres of influence of Grass Valley, and the general plan support a business park with mixed use plus residential. Now Grass Valley is prevented from exercising this option in the future.
Again, all I can tell you is that it's zoned for commercial industrial, and that is the cleanup that the owner wants to achieve. That is the cleanup they anticipate using this site for. So, you know, we can't mandate that the owner clean up to residential if he's not going to use it for residential. Like I said, if down the road that changes and they want to use it for residential purposes 50 years from now, they will have to show who's ever in my place that it meets a residential cleanup level of use. And that would, you know, that would mean probably having to do some additional work, obviously. So all I can tell you is they've decided to use it for commercial industrial right now. And that is what we're going to mandate that they clean up to, because that's how they intend to use it. And you know, we don't really have a say, DTSC doesn't have a say in mandating anything more stringent than that if it's not going to be used for anything more stringent than that.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from Jonathan Keehan. Jonathan.
Oh, okay, great. Thanks for taking my second question. And I'm actually just wanted to follow up on your response to Ray Breyer's thought about possibly cleaning up the hot spots themselves, which, and maybe they won't be as bad as you think, as they appear to be. So if I understood you correctly, you kind of thought that was a possibility. Let's see. As you know, this site was used as a mine waste dump site for less than 100 years, really. It's been another over 70 years since it's been closed, and there's a tremendous amount of recovery already on the site. I'm sure you've walked around it. You've seen the large trees, the cottonwoods and other trees, and the riparian zones that are there, the wetlands, et cetera. So it's a very valuable site already. It's already spent 70 years recovering itself. So that's really promising to me that it's possible you could reduce the amount of remediation that's necessary. So how do you clarify that in your RAP right now, that possibility should be addressed very clearly and early on before any trees, for instance, are removed and before any wetlands are disturbed?
I think it's in there in the remedial action plan. If you look, we do talk about doing some pre-excavation sampling to take a look at some of those hot spots, because we do want to confirm that we actually have to go in there and do that. And we want to see, you know, how much that would be. But so it's the pre-excavation sampling is talked about in the remedial action plan. It will be something, again, you know, this is an expensive endeavor. They're not going to do anything that they don't need to, you know, they're not going to pay for anything that they don't have to pay for. So if they can do their confirmation sampling on some of these small areas where they just want to confirm, do we really need to go in here and do this? You know, they're going to do that ahead of time. And, you know, that I don't, again, the remedial design implementation plan will kind of spell out exactly the steps that will be taken, but I would almost guarantee that they will want to collect whatever confirmation, or I should say, you know, pre-excavation samples firsthand, just to know exactly where they want to be. I wouldn't imagine they would go in and spend money on clearing and what have you if they know there's a whole area that they're not going to have to deal with. Having said that, again, I do know that there's quite a bit of material we're going to need for the regrading, and quite a bit of material we're going to need for the capping. So even if there are some areas that may not need to be have some small hotspot excavation, they still might be designated as borrow area. So they, you know, they might get utilized in that fashion. But again, I you know, these are smart engineers and you know, businessmen. They're not going to want to spend money when they don't have to. So that, I think the pre-excavation sampling will occur first. Subsequent steps will be taken after that.
Thank you, Jonathan, for your question. We'll take a question from the Q&A from Barbara Ravine. This site is being cleaned up to the industrial M1 level. However, that is the county's old destination, whereas the county of Grass Valley has it in its sphere of influence as a business park, which is considerably more of a high level of cleanup.
Well, a business park is still considered commercial. So commercial industrial use takes into account business park environment. So yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it could be a big warehouse, but it also could be a, you know, a business, an office space, if they wanted to use it for that matter. The cleanup will meet both uses. You know, commercial industrial is safe for both types of use.
Okay. Now we have a question from Rhea Williamson. Rhea?
Thank you so much, both of you, Dean and Tammy, for doing this and providing this opportunity. My question's related to the decision to stabilize the TP19 hotspot on site instead of removing it to an outside facility, disposal facility, which already has all of the monitoring, safety protocols installed, such as a hazardous waste site. I think what you said was there's 4,200 cubic yards. Using your 17 cubic yards per truck, we're looking at 247 trucks. You could completely bypass the need to do this stabilization with concrete, which, you know, somebody asked earlier about the TCLP, about the leaching over time. And so that was my original question. I'm wondering, since anyone who's done any engineering with landfills knows every cap leaks pretty much when you stabilize with concrete breaks down over time. When you have acidic water, such as rainwater, and there are numerous studies that show this, you can have leaching of arsenic and other contaminants from the concrete. I'm just wondering why, given the potential for future contamination down the road, and the fact that this is a much consolidated area offsite transport of these more highly concentrated contaminated soils wasn't considered?
Well, probably a couple things there. I mean, you mentioned the number of trucks needed to take that offsite. You know, it's in about 250. I think they're only anticipating about 25 or 26 concrete trucks would have to come to the site to do the consolidation work. So there's a pretty significant difference there. The other thing is we think it's going to work. We think it will be effective, and it will be tested, like I said, before we put it back in the consolidation area to make sure that it's effective. But in the long run, you're right. I mean, we're going to have to monitor this site, and nothing lasts forever. So that's why we do this long-term monitoring. So if 100 years from now, let's say, things start to break down and we notice that the stabilization effort has started to wear a little thin, maybe they have to 100 years from now go into that area and restabilize. That's, again, probably still cheaper than shipping off to 200, you know, to another landfill for at the cost of 250 different trucks through the community. But it was just an evaluation of the number of trucks and the cost to do it, the fact that we believe it will be effective, and the fact that we're going to have to monitor anyway, because again, this is mine waste. You have to monitor it when you leave it in place, when you leave waste in place. It just made sense to try and do it here. I see your point. I mean, I out of sight, out of mind, and it's not a problem anymore, but there's still a cost associated with that. And that cost is a criteria that has to be looked at.
Thank you, Rhea, for that question. I'll now take a question from the Q&A. Paul Schwartz asks, is the site safety inspector independent of the landowner?
They will be, well, obviously the landowner is paying for this work. So in that sense, everything is coming through him. But yeah, I mean, that site safety officer will be following the health and safety plan and the dust mitigation plan and what have you that DTSC is overseeing, that DTSC is approving. So in that sense, he's following what the regulating agencies are mandating that he follow. It's not like he's a direct employee of the owner. He would be probably a consultant, and he would be following the project documents that are approved by DTSC.
Okay. Now we have a question from Greg Thrash. Greg.
Yes. Hi. Thank you, Tammy and Dean, for this opportunity to comment. I had put into the Q&A my questions, but it's evolving, so you can ignore them. But I just was curious. Does the applicant for the voluntary cleanup agreement have an obligation to clean up the site, regardless of whether the mine is approved or not?
They do not. This is a voluntary cleanup agreement. They would be on the hook if they exacerbated a problem on the site. But again, in fact, this was alluded to a couple of questions ago. There have been other owners of this property that have thought they were going to step up to the plate and do things, and they've turned around and left. And they were not responsible for cleaning up the site because they didn't do anything while they owned it. And since it's a voluntary cleanup agreement type project, we didn't have a hook to force them to. If indeed they decide, hey, we're not going to do this, they can turn and walk. Obviously they're not going to get to use the property the way they want. I think they've taken the long lean look at this and realized that this is an expensive step that they're taking, but in the long run, it's, what they want to do so that they can reuse this site. So, but under a voluntary cleanup agreement, no, they, unless they exacerbate a problem, they would only be responsible for dealing with that issue that they made worse.
Thank you, Greg. I'm going to take a question from the Q&A. Ralph Silverstein. Updating my question, is it true that currently most of the site is suitable for unrestricted use? Why is it being downgraded to industrial?
Ralph, I don't think it's, I don't think most of it is suitable for unrestricted use. I mean, there's like, you can see those areas where we're excavating and consolidating, that those are pretty sizable chunks. And, you know, frankly, I couldn't tell you whether the rest of it is, you know, certainly some of it is residential. I don't know which parts, that hasn't been mapped out, but again, this is a commercial industrial cleanup as you know, determined by what the owner wants to achieve and how it's zoned. So that is what we're going to mandate that they clean up to.
Okay, now we're going to go to Donald Ravines. Donald has a question. Donald.
Yes. I received the reviewed the alternatives. It looks like alternative 4 is the best alternative. Hauling the TP-19 hotspot toxic material offsite to Nevada or Central California would permanently dispose of the material offsite. Required fill would seem to be less and could be brought in by truck by allowing the rest of the Centennial site borrow areas to have minimal impact. So my one question is, would there be less fill required over that site, the toxic site, once you removed it all? And secondly, the idea that it would require 250 truck trips, that's about one or two trips a day for a year. For comparison, the proposed nearby mine is contemplating 722 concentrate trucks going 145 miles every year for 80 years. So could you comment on whether the fill requirement would be less than that of alternative 5?
I'm not sure I follow the question. I think what you're asking was if you did remove the 4,200 cubic yards at TP-19, would you then have more space to put the mine waste in the other areas into that spot where you had to remove soil? Obviously you would. You'd have 4,200 cubic yards of extra space in the consolidation area. But again, these were, the criteria that we look at includes, it includes cost, it includes effectiveness. And we think we can effectively deal with that TP-19 hotspot on site with that concrete application. We're going to test it. I think I mentioned that, and we're going to show that we can do that before it's placed back in there. But we think that's a viable approach. It's been used before, and you're talking about 26 concrete trucks versus 250 or so trucks to take the waste away. That's a fair amount of difference. I think there are some cost comparisons in there between the various options that were evaluated, and there's definitely a cost difference there as well. So, when we looked at everything, it was option 5 seemed to become the most attractive and a very effective approach to cleaning up the site. So, I recognize that it's always nice for the people that are going to be living with this right next door to have the site, to have the waste completely removed. But when you remove it, you're not really getting rid of it. You're going to have to monitor it somewhere else with this type of waste. So monitoring it right here and avoiding all the truck traffic and the extra costs that go along with that just seemed to make sense in this case. We think we can do it effectively, and if we can't, if the efficacy of the stabilization shows, hey, it's not going to work, then removing it will have to happen. But right now, the plan is to consolidate it, show that effectiveness, which will be made public, in the removal action completion report or the remedial action completion report, and show the public that this site will be safe and it is going to be safe for the long term.
Thank you for that question. We'll now read another question from Christy Hubert. What is the timeline for completion of this project? Will Rise Gold be obligated to enter into an agreement to provide funds or complete the work in a specific timeline?
Not within a specific timeline, no. Again, this is a voluntary agreement, so we don't really have hooks that we can get the work done in that fashion. I mean, we try and work with them to be as efficient as possible, but it's really their calendar that's going to dictate. I would imagine they anticipate about a 4 to 6 month effort to complete this project. Of course, that'll be dependent on weather and what have you. And they're seeing as how it's what, almost mid-August, and by the time we, you know, if we indeed approve this removal action plan, and if we, you know, by the time we get through the remedial design implementation plan, we'll be well into the wet season, so they'll probably wait until spring. So it'd probably be, you know, at least through the winter until we even get out in the field. And then again, it's a 4 to 6 month anticipated timeline to complete the project. So we'll work with them as efficiently as we can, but we don't have any incentives, if you will, or sticks either to mandate that they do it faster.
Okay, then we're going to take another question from Aaron Crowell. Aaron?
In your opinion, my question is, what is safer for the residents of Nevada County having, again, you know, received mercury poisoning from a collapsed gold mine tunnel? What would be safer, in your opinion, to not mine this area again and leave it as it lies, or to do this cleanup, capping it where it is and leaving it there and then not mining again on top of it? What is the safest option for the residents who live on groundwater and rely on much of what this community already offers?
Well, certainly the cleanup we're proposing is going to be safer than the site as it exists now, especially if it's going, you know, with the reuse. We don't want people reusing this site in its current state. It's not safe. So yes, the site will be safer once we clean it up. In terms of the mine operation, you know, obviously it depends on how they operate that mine and what regulations in place are in place, you know, for its operation. Hopefully they do it safely. It's again, that's not part of this project. I'm not sure how to answer that question. I think you can do things safely. I think that the proposed remedy that we're offering in this remedial action plan is going to make this site safer for the community. And that's what we're focused on, is making this site safe for the community. So outside of this project, you know, there's a lot of things that you can do that might be safe, might be unsafe. I don't know anything about how they're going to operate that mine. So I really don't know if it will be safe for the community. I would imagine they're going to be pretty well regulated. But again, that's really out of our jurisdiction and really not part of this project.
Okay. Thank you for that question. Now we'll go to the Q&A. Don and Jane Pendleton, about monitoring, will DTSC monitoring as opposed to the owner self-reporting, how frequently and will the monitoring results be publicly available?
Yes. So I guess for groundwater monitoring, typically what we do is start out with quarterly, and then based on those results, we might move to semi-annually and then annual. And it may be even way down the line if things look like they're pretty stable and safe, we might go to less than that. But that's typically how we start out with groundwater monitoring. And all those reports are made publicly available on our DTSC database. In terms of the inspections, those are also made available on our DTSC database. So the review and inspection of any cap repairs, any changes in the cap, things of that nature, all of that is documented in the annual, what are typically annual reviews. And those are all made available on our DTSC database. Again, in this case, if they end up using this site as a repository for additional mine waste, I would imagine our inspections would probably be more often than annual, you know, at least why that additional, you know, soil is being brought on site. But again, what those protocols would be, I really can't say at this point. But typically we do annual inspections on a cap that's not changing.
Okay.
And that's made available to the public.
Thank you for that. Wade Laughter asks, what will be done to protect the remediation from inevitable flooding along Wolf Creek? I see a historical berm that looks inadequate for flooding that happened there in the winter of 2017.
Obviously, the cap, as I said, is going to be compacted and graded. Final cap design is going to be included in their remedial design implementation plan, but it's going to have to take into account, current codes for flooding and what have you. So, I mean, those types of storm events and those types of issues will have to be taken into account when they design the cap and how they design the runoff and things of that nature. I think right now they're even at this early stage, they have what I think is called a kind of a retention basin that they'll employ to ensure that they don't impact Wolf Creek too much and to ensure that storm events are handled appropriately. But the cap design is really something that the engineers are going to be working on and looking at as part of their remedial design implementation plan. Again, what we are trying to show you today is kind of the what we're proposing and the how. Those are all considerations that we have to take into consideration and things that we have to design the cap for, but we haven't done that cap design yet. But we understand that, yeah, we have to ensure that we don't inundate Wolf Creek and that we build a cap and a consolidation area that can accommodate those kinds of flood events and storm events.
Okay. Jude Daly, can you explain what aspects might have changed by Rise Gold entering into a cleanup contract with DTSC versus allowing the site to remain eligible for Superfund status? Would DTSC still be involved if it has been assigned to a Superfund?
We might. Typically, Superfund can be run, starts out with EPA. And then, they'll do what they call emergency response work. And then at some point they turn it over to the state to handle. So, but I don't even know if this site would meet Superfund. I don't know if that evaluation I know they talked about it. I don't know if it was something that the site would meet the parameters for Superfund. But because we have a project proponent that's willing and able to do work right now, it makes sense to go ahead and try and clean this site up with their dime, frankly. We're going to get a site that's been dormant and vacant and unused for, 80 plus years and get it put back into productive use of some sort and safe for the community, certainly safer than it exists right now. So those are good things. And because we have a proponent that's willing to do that, it makes sense to jump at the opportunity, I think.
Thank you. Jean Wilson, your presentation notes the site does not create an environmental hazard as it stands. In fact, after 80 years of recovery, this area has become a home, thriving native parents, plants, and wildlife community, including whispering, and wetlands, both adjacent to Wolf Creek and throughout much of the site. Yet the plan calls for moving 130,000 cubic yards of uncontaminated soil from the area of the eastern burn to be piled up on top of contaminated soil, and also removing and using as a fill another 133,000 cubic yards of material throughout the Rispin and wetlands area associated with Wolf Creek. Isn't there a responsibility to try to minimize ecological impacts of the site and to mitigate if possible?
There is actually, you're quite right. And actually the CEQA initial study talks about mitigation measures for the ecological aspects of the project. I guess the brunt of your question is, it kind of sounds like you want to go, or you're, sounds like you would rather not use material on the site for the cap and the regrading. But again, that not doing so really presents a huge issue with the amount of soil that have to be brought on for those purposes. But that said, there are mitigation measures in place for special status species. You know, those are the species listed as proposed for listing on the threatened or endangered U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, endangered list. We have identified, I think, one special status species on the project, the Pine Hill Flannel Bush. Luckily for us, it's located in the southern area of the site, and we don't think we're going to impact that area at all. So that special status species is going to be fine. There was a biology basically review and study done on the site, which found habitat for six other special status species. So we didn't find the species, but they found habitat, and there's mitigation measures in place because that habitat exists. And those mitigation measures basically begin with trying to avoid, if we can, all the way to removing the species by a qualified biologist if we have to. Those mitigation measures are in place. They're discussed in detail in the initial study. And if a special status species is documented within the site, there will be a site-specific habitat management plan that will be prepared to comply with the county land use codes and ensure appropriate mitigation measures are followed. But the bigger issue is, not using any of the clean soil that's on site for the regrading and the capping. And again, we looked at that, and you're talking about 130,000 cubic yards of soil that would have to come from somewhere else. And that is just a huge issue, not only with emissions, greenhouse gas, traffic, cost, a number of things. And it just made sense to try and do it all on site. And yes, that means some wetlands that might get destroyed for that purpose. But again, they'll have to work with the Corps of Engineers to deal with that in the manner that I think I talked about before, which is one-to-one restoration elsewhere, or I think it's a mitigation credits, wetland credits or what have you. There's some different options open to them. I'm not sure exactly what all they are, but they'll have to work with the Corps to do that. But it made the most sense in this case to use the site, or to use the soil we have on the site that we can use. It was just a far more effective approach.
Now we're going to go into the formal comment section tonight. We do have extra questions that, but we're going to move those into the formal comments due to time. This way individuals can leave formal comments regarding this project. So if we can go to, comments can be made verbally on this meeting. Comments can be submitted in writing three ways: using the Q&A feature during this meeting, by mail addressing to Dean Wright at 8800 Cal Center Drive, Sacramento, California, 95826, or email sent to dean.wright@dtsc.ca.gov. Dean's email is posted in the chat. After the review of the comment period ends on August 24th, 2021, DTSC will prepare a response to all the comments and revise the wrap as needed. Next slide. To use the Zoom audio, use the raise hand feature, and you will be invited to unmute your audio when it's your turn. By phone, press star 9 to join the phone crew, queue, and then press star 6 to unmute your line. Text to have your comment read by me, the facilitator, please use the Q&A feature. Next slide. Public comment period started July 26th through August 24th, 2021. You can send public your comments to Dean Wright, the project manager at 8800 Cal Center Drive, Sacramento, California, 95826, or his email at dean.wright@dtsc.ca.gov. Meeting and project materials are located on the EnviroStore database at www.envirostore.dtsc.ca.gov at ID number 600716. Okay, and we can start the comments. Just know when we start the comments, Dean will not be answering. We'll just be taking comments. Okay, so we'll enter questions that was left over from the Q&A from Ray Barris. Instead of 4, could some of the South TP19 hotspots be moved on site to the east area with clean soil brought into cover? This could allow much of the existing South wetlands to remain. The next comment is coming from Barbara Ravines. How is DTSC assuring the cost of this project will be reimbursed? The next comment will be from Rhea Williamson. Extending the comment period is done via process that was used at the Santa Susana site by DTSC Steve Becker, who signed the volunteer cleanup agreement for the Centennial site. It seems a reasonable request for this site. Will you please look into it? The next comment comes from Ralph Silverstein. Per your response about the wetland mitigations, why did you state that the wetlands could not be rebuilt on site? On site restoration is generally preferred. There seems to be excessive unnecessary habitats destructions with this plan. The next comment is from Josie Crawford. In RISE Goals initial technical report, they stated they would do their best to stay within the setbacks to protect Wolf Creek. They have already shown a total disregard for the setback rules when they did their exploratory drilling. Will there be someone on site to monitor their work in regards to protecting the creek? Can there be a biologist, for instance? The next comment is from Reed Hamilton. Does the mining company have to post bond to cover the monitoring for 100 years, or does it fall on taxpayers if they go bankrupt? The next comment is from James Baer. Dean, your long range considerations and prediction don't sound like you're taking into account the tailings, 1,000 tons per day being added to the site by RISE Mine. Does that include monitoring errors and other predictions, uncertainties longer term? The next comment is from Ray Bears. I noticed that so far there have not been any questions from Grass Valley City Council members or Nevada County Supervisor. Does that indicate they have no interest or discussion taking place? The next comment and last comment is from Ralph Silverstein. It seems as if the cleanup plan is assuming that the mine project will be approved. However, this is quite a presumption. Is equal focus being given to the correct way to clean up this site in case of no mine? Is the excessive grading and habitat removal in the borough areas really what would be done if the presumption of dumping mine waste did not materialize. We don't have any more comments at this time. So I would like to say thank you for attending this meeting. And you can always contact Dean. Oh, there's one more comment. And Tracy Sheehan states, please consider extending the comment period for at least 45 days or consistent with other similar cleanups. Now we're closing the formal comment period. So comments can be sent to Dean Wright, the project manager at DTSC, 8800 Cal Center Drive, Sacramento, California, 95826, or at his email at dean.wright@dtsc.ca.gov. You can also find the documents at the EnviroStore link at www.envirostore.dtsc.ca.gov, ID number 6000716. Next slide. Thank you for your attendance. On behalf of DTSC, we thank you for joining us. Please stay safe and be well.